Right, welcome to this video tutorial on
ICT on the, of the IGCSE ICT. Okay, so I'm going to be looking at paper 3, data analysis. All right, paper 3. Okay, and this is the mid-June 2018 examination series. To be precise, I'm going to be looking at paper 3.1 components. Okay. So like I said before, I'm going to be looking at data analysis, how you can type in the formulas to get the correct results. Okay, so where's paper 3, where's data analytics in this paper? Okay, so we have it here on task 3. So you will need a spreadsheet program to complete this task. Okay, so I would like you to take your time to watch this video, and I believe that at the end you'll be able to gain powerful understanding that you can use to solve related papers. Okay, so I'm going to concentrate on the formulas. Okay, I'm not interested in the so many buttons of your in the ribbon of your spreadsheet program. Okay, so I'm going to take you through the nitty-gritty of how you can type the formulas, okay, and get the correct result. So you really need to take your time very well to watch this video, okay, and I'm going to show you how you can format all this, and then how you can restrict data entry to a particular cell. In this case, we're going to restrict data entry in cell B4, and so many other things that we are going to be learning from this paper today. Okay, so the very first thing that you need to do, let me go back to the beginning again. Yes, the very first thing that you need to do, you will need your evidence document. Okay, you will need this evidence document. But the very first thing that you need to do is to create a work area. Now, a work area is a folder in your name. Okay, a work area is a folder in your name. Okay, so I need to quickly do that right now. So let me quickly do that. So let me go to my desktop. All right, so this is my desktop. Okay, desktop. So a new folder. All right, so let me name it as my name. Okay, so this is a folder in my name. That's my work area. Then I need to find and locate the source file and copy all the files into my work area. So this is my source file that I want to use. Alright, so this source file will be ready for you on the desktop. So you just need to double click and open. Just press Ctrl A. If you're using a standard keyboard, Ctrl A, and you can copy it from here. You see copy top here. Copy and move up once, so I get to my work area. Then I can paste it from here. All right, so I have the source files right now inside my work area, which is a folder in my name. Okay, so now let's go to task 1. Task 1 is always that you should prepare your evidence document. Now this is another one that is very important. You need to prepare your evidence document. Evidence document, you will need it to show screenshots of all the work that you're doing. All right, so they said we should open J1831 evidence, and we should make sure your name, center number, candidate number will appear on every page of your evidence document. Okay, and we should place these details in the header. Now when you place your name, center number, candidate number in the header, it's going to appear on every page. okay? It's going to appear on every page. So then we'll save it as a Word document. You can see that it is in rich text format, RTF, rich text format. So we have to save it in a Word document, okay? So we'll do that. And also we have to name it like this, such that we add our candidate number, we append our candidate number like this, okay? So they gave us an example, and okay, you need to play screenshot and answer. Okay, that's the purpose of the evidence document. So let's quickly do that. Okay, let's quickly do so. I will just come here, and this is the evidence document here that they were talking about. So I will just double click. All right, this first step is common to both paper 2 and paper 3. You have to prepare the evidence document, and you have to do that correctly. Okay, so they said we should place our name in the header. So I will go to insert. Okay, now in the insert group on the ribbon, you are going to see header here. So just click on the arrow underneath. Okay, then select three column header. So I'll do that. So let me put my name. Okay, please type in your full name. Okay, please type in your full name. All right, don't abbreviate, let it be full. So let me assume this center number here for the sake of this paper, GH888, and let me just say my candidate number is 001. Okay, all right, so I will close header and footer. They said we should save it as a Word document, and we should add our candidate number. In this case, we have I am 001, so let's do that. Okay, I will save as file, save as. Then make sure you browse to your work area. Now this is my work area, okay, on the desktop. So now I'll change it to Word document. Just change it from here on the save as type, select Word document, then I will just click this and add 001. Okay, so I click on save, click OK. All right, you can see on top here that the name of the file is now a Word document file. Okay, so our evidence document is nice and ready. So our name is there, our center number is there, and the candidate number is showing properly. Okay, so let's now I told you that I'm going to look at I'm going to look at data analysis. So let's go to where we have data analysis on this paper. Okay, so all right, task 3. Okay, spreadsheet. Okay, said you are going to prepare a spreadsheet model to calculate the number of bricks used to build a wall. Okay, please, it's very important you read and understand. Read. Once they've written it there, that means it's required that you read it and understand what they're talking about. Okay, all right, so step number 14 says identify the symbols used within spreadsheet formulae within spreadsheet formulae for the following mathematical operators. Okay, identify the formula used within spreadsheet formulae for the following mathematical operators. Okay, so we have what are the multiply, divide, to the power of is not equal to okay, so it said we should type the symbols in the table in your evidence document. So there's a table, let's go and check, and this is evidence 5. Okay, there's a table here, really. Okay, so we have to type the symbol here. So for multiply, the symbol is just simply asterisk. If you are using the standard keyboard, you get that from Shift 8. Shift 8, we give you asterisk. Okay, so the next one is divide. Divide is just simply forward slash, okay, on your keyboard. And we have to the power of, okay, to the power of, to the power of, you need the caret sign. If you are using a standard keyboard, again, you will get that from Shift 6, this sign, the caret sign. Okay, that will give you the power. That will give you power. Okay, the last one say is not equal to. All right, this is not equal to. You can't get it from your keyboard. All right, you know in mathematics we can write, this is equal to, and this is in math we can say, cross it like this and say this is not equal to. Okay. This is not equal to when we this is beg your pardon, let me make it clear. So when you write like this and you cross it, you say this is not equal to. Okay, but in your keyboard you won't, there's no, in your standard keyboard you won't find this character to press. Okay, so the way that Excel interprets your not equal to is when you type the less than and the greater than facing each other like this. So your spreadsheet program is able to interpret this symbol as not equal to. Okay, so we'll just type less than then greater than facing each other, and that will give us the not equal to. So let me type it there. So sure, I get that. So like this. So this is the not equal to. Okay, that is the not equal to. Okay, so that is done. That's format correctly, typed correctly. That's format. So that's done. Okay, saving your evidence document. Please, it's very important that you save. We saved this file before, but as you walk along, as you keep on adding new content, always click on this save button, right? As you are adding new content, click on the save button. Okay, so I have done that right now. So now I said open the J183 one estimator, okay, and the J131 bricks, okay, in a spreadsheet package and examine the contents. Okay, now when they say you should examine files like this, there's something that they want you to pick from it. There's an information they want you to get, so it's deliberate. Because they say you should open and examine, it's deliberate, examine the content. So let's quickly open those two files and see what is and see what's there. So we'll go back to our work area. All right, let me open, this is the estimator. So I'll open the estimator, just double click and it opens. Let me make it bigger for you. Okay, so this is the estimator. Try to double click on the boundary between the columns so that you expand everything. Make sure everything is fitting in the cell, all the labels are fitting in the cell. So expand by clicking on the boundary between columns. All right, okay, what is here? I can see Bobby Briggs. Cost estimator for Bobby Briggs. Okay, I can see please enter S or D, so that means we're likely to be having some values in here. I can see please enter brick code. Okay, that means we're likely to enter some value here. Okay, so all right, okay, so that's, so let's go to the other file and see the bricks file. Let's double click again. Okay, so this is the bricks Spotify. Again, double click the column boundaries and try to see everything that is in there. All right, you can see here we have brick code. All right, we have brick code. Okay, let's check the other file. They said please enter brick code here. So this brick code and this brick code here is a common value. So brick code is going to be a link between the two files. All right, so it's likely to be a lookup value. It's going to be a lookup value. So it's going to be a lookup value. This brick code is going to be a lookup value. We are going to see that as we progress through the paper. Okay, so that's done. I've examined the file, examined the content. Okay, the next step says, the next step of this bullet point say edit the estimator file so that it look like this. Okay, so let's quickly do that. So we are going to estimate the, we are going to format the estimator file to look like this. Okay, so let's quickly do that. All right, so go back again and see. If you look here carefully, you will see that row one is merged to, is merged from A1 to C1, is merged, and also row 2 is merged from A2 to C2. Okay, so and row 3 is adjusted a bit. You can see that the row number 3 is not showing, so there's an adjustment there. All right, and you can also see that the grid lines, they are bold. The grid lines are bold. So let's quickly merge row 1 to C1, from A1 to C1. Let's merge that. So I will just align to C1 and merge. Okay, so that's done. Then also let's merge A1 to A2 to C2. So do that again. So merge center up here. You see merge and center. So the next thing we should make it big. Bobby Bricks should be big. So let me increase the font size. Let's say 36. I think it's bolding. So something like this. Then let's see. The cost estimator is also bolding. So let me increase it a bit. Let's say something like this. Okay, and let me make it bold. And there's a gray fill background. It's a gray fill background. So on the border, on the fill color here for the borders for background. So I'll just select a gray fill like this. Okay, select a gray fill like this. Also with this space, select a gray fill like this. Okay, so it's gradually looking like this. The next thing now I need to do, let me adjust this row 3 like that. Let's see. So this is row 3, so I will adjust it like this. Okay, all right, so the next thing now is to make it all the grid lines are showing properly like this. So I will just align everything like this. Let's say like this, and then come here where you have bottom borders, where you have borders. This is the borders button. Okay, so I will click on the arrow beside it and choose okay wait, you can see here that the borders around Bobby Bricks and cost estimator is bordered round, not the cell. So let's do it separately. So let me make this to be all round, something like this, outside borders like this. Okay, so something like this. Then I will now highlight all this one here, highlight all this one here like this, and make it all borders. Okay, something like this. to make this one all borders as well. Okay, so I think it's almost like this right now. So the next thing is say save the spreadsheet with the file name J1831_ followed by your center number, candidate number, just like this. Okay, so let's quickly do that. So I click on file, save as. Please make sure you browse to your work area. All right, so I'm going to remove the estimator from the file name and say underscore, let me check, followed by your center number, candidate number, so underscore. So I am using GH888, okay, comma 0001. All right, and also let me change it to an Excel file, to the package. I'm using an Excel spreadsheet right now, so I've changed it to the Excel file. Okay, all right, so I'm going to save it. So that's done. So and this is seven marks. So that's very important, you know how to format your spreadsheet like this. Okay, so said take a screenshot showing say A1 to C12 of your spreadsheet. Okay, it said including the role and column headings, place this in your evidence document. Okay, so let's quickly, that's easy. So I'll come here like this now and get my screenshot software. So I'll capture like this. Okay, capture like this. Okay, so I'll copy it and go to my evidence document, evidence 6. So come under evidence 6 like this and paste it there. Okay, so you can see it's looking like the one on the question paper. So let me adjust this a bit. Okay, so all right, so that's done. So let's move on to the next step. Here, what are they talking about? Said place your name, center number and candidate number in the center of the header. Please, it is very important you read carefully. All right, don't assume, make sure you read the instruction. Okay, say place your name, center number, candidate number in the center of the header. All right, okay, so let's quickly do that. Okay, so how do you get to the header here? You still go to the insert group. Under the insert group on the ribbon, you go to header, click on header and footer. All right, so it's going to appear like this. Okay, so so they say we should place it in the center of the header. So this is the center, this is the left, this is the center, this is the right. So the center, so I'm going to place what are we placing? Your name. Okay, so I'm using, okay, Chuku Eku, so comma, center number HG888, comma 0001. Okay, all right, so that's done. All right, then the next bullet point is saying that we should place an automated file name including the file part on the right in the footer. Okay, all right, so this is pretty easy. So if you look up here, you will see go to footer. All right, go to footer. So just click on go to footer. You can see here that we are at the footer right now, but let's see, where did they say we should put it? They say on the right, on the right. So it's not the center, it's on the right. So this is the right, this is my right. Okay, so now we are going to add the file part on the right, file name including the file part. Okay, so let's see. So click the placeholder of the right footer, then you see up here, you see file part, file part. So just click on it once. Okay, once. Now when you click on it once, you are going to see and part and file. What that means is that the file part and the file name has been added. Okay, the file part and the file name. So just click on it once. There's no need to click on the file name here again. Just click the file part. It's going to add the file part and the file name. Okay, so once you are done, all right, once you are done, you just click on click on down here, you see normal. Just click on normal. Okay, click on the spreadsheet, then you can see the file part and the file name has been added. So I'll just click on normal. So I go back to normal. Okay, so I return back to normal. Okay, all right, so that's done. Another thing you will notice that you can't find the header, that's the file part, your name that you've just added. Okay, it has been added. All right, at the time you want to print this document, you are going to find it where you have placed it. So don't worry that you can't find it here, it has been added. Once you add it, just as I have explained, it is there. Alright, so like I said before, you always save. So I will click on the save button. Okay, so just click on the save button to save. As you are adding new content, okay, as you're adding new content, you click on the save button. Alright, so let's go to the next step. Alright, so what are they talking about here? Say for steps 17 to 20, you may enter test data to help you create your model. Okay, all right, so no problem. 17 to 20, so we're going to be texting and creating the model. Okay, so step number 17 says restrict the data entry in cell B4 to S or D. Okay, you should restrict it to S or D. This is more like validation, more like data validation, so that only X or D is permitted in this cell. Okay, only X or D is permitted in this cell. So that's what we are going to do right now. So let's go to cell B4 and restrict the cell to contain only X or D. So this is row 4 and this is cell B4. Okay, so once you click on cell B4, all right, that's, you have to click on cell B4 first, then go to data. All right, so on the data group of the ribbon, you are going to see data validation at this right hand side, close to the middle of the ribbon. So click on the arrow underneath and you see data validation. So it's going to open up this dialog box. Okay, now we have any value. No, it's not any value. We are going to, let me change it to list. So I'll change it to list. And where you have source, the source, the data for the source is X comma D. So S comma D. S comma D. All right. So that's the okay, I'm going to type X or D. Sorry for that break. I'm going to type, so I just finished typing X or D and I click on okay. Click on okay. Okay, so alright, so we have validated this cell to only contain S or T. we have validated this set to only contain X or D. Okay, so that's the that's how to restrict the cell to contain a particular value. Okay, so let's see what next. Okay, evidence. Alright, so take a screenshot of your method of restricting the data entry. Place this in your evidence document. Okay, so that means we have to go back there again. So while it is, the cell is still activated, I will just click on data validation. So I'll take a screenshot of this to show how I did it. Okay, so I'll take a screenshot to show how I did it. So let me copy. All right, so I click on OK. So evidence 7. So let me I'll need to drop this down to the next page and place the evidence. So I paste it here. Okay, so that's it. So you can adjust a bit, okay, but don't over resize it so that it's not too small. All right, so that when you print it, it's clear for them to see, the examiner to see. Okay, so that's fine. All right, so now step number 18 says enter a formula in cell B10 to display single if cell B4 contain X and double if cell B4 contain T. Okay, now remember this is the X and the D that they're talking about. So if cell B4 is containing X, so we are going to display single, and if cell B4 or if cell B4 is containing D, so we are going to display double. So you can see here, if is the if function. All right, if is the if function. So we just need to use the if function to get this done. All right, and we are going to place this formula in B10. So let's quickly do that. So this is row 10 and this is B10. Okay, so now remember, don't forget, you start a formula with the equal to sign. All right, so I will just type the equal to. Okay, all right, so I open a bracket, and like I said before, I'm going to be explaining this formula for you. All right, now your spreadsheet program, Microsoft Excel, when you start a function, it's going to give you some hints. That was the reason why I said I'm not interested in the many buttons in the ribbons. But once you start the formula like this, it's going to give you a clue of what the formula should contain. Okay, now you can see here it's telling us the first thing that we need to type inside this function is the logical text. Okay, the logical text. Okay, now the logical text, the computer is going to check the logical text. If it's true, it's going to return this value, that's value if true. And if it is false, it's going to return the value if false. Okay, so those are the three things that we go into this formula right now as it takes. Okay, so logical text. So the logical test is we are checking if cell B4 is X. So if cell B4 is X, so if cell B4, this is cell B4. So if B4 is equal to X, okay, if cell B4 is equal to X, okay, alright, now you can see that I put the X inside the speech mark, okay, inside the quotation mark. Okay, so I'm doing that because it's a string, it's a character. So anytime you are typing a character in a function in your spreadsheet program, it's done by putting it inside the speech mark. All right, so that's the standard. Okay, so Now the next thing is value if true. So comma, value if true. What's the value if true? The value if true is single. The value if true is single. Is single. That's the value if true. Again, I need to put it inside the speech mark. So single. All right. Sorry. Single, okay, comma, speech mark again, no man can see the end of your speech mark, no man can know the end of your love, double. Okay, all right, so speech mark double. But let me check, please, when you're typing the formula, make sure you type the formula as it is. You can see here, this is single, all small case. This is single, all small case. So I'm going to correct this. Please, 100% accurate. 100% accurate, please. Double. Alright, then once you're done, you can close the bracket like this. You can see that the hint has disappeared. So once you finish typing your formula and the bracket or the parenthesis is closed properly, that hint is going to disappear. The hint, you can see the hint down here. This hint is going to disappear. So that's one of the ways that you know that you have typing the parenthesis very well. Okay, so once you put like that, so it's going to disappear. So I'll click on okay. All right, so you can see that it's not X, so it's displaying double. So if I select X now, okay, it's going to display single, and if it's not X, that means it's D and it's going to display double. So the function or the formula is working perfectly. Okay, so that is how to get that done. So the next step now is step number 19. Okay, so step number 19, we should enter a function in cell B9 to look up the name of the type of brick using the file. So we are going to use this file to look up the name of the type of brick. Remember, they told us that we should examine the file. All right, we should examine those two files, and this is one of them. Okay, so we are going to look up this file and return the name of the brick. Okay, I'm going to look up this file and return the name of the brick. This was what I was telling you, that what we are going to use to look up this name from the calculator file, from the model, is going to be the brick code, because that's a common data between this file and this other file. So brick code is what makes it common. So anytime they ask you, you are typing a lookup function, you have to use a lookup value. A lookup value is the link, is a common value between both files. So that's what they are going to use to link both files together. Okay, so let's see how we get this done. Now the formula is going to be on cell B9. Okay, on cell B9. So let's go there, cell B9. So that's this place, so B9. So we're going to return the name of the brick here. Okay, so again, I will type equal to. All right, so VLOOKUP. Okay, VLOOKUP. Now I'm using a VLOOKUP because the table, you can see that the table is a vertical table. The data, they are in vertical order. All right, the brick code is lining vertically, and the brick name is also lining or standing vertically. Okay, the brick code is standing vertically and the brick name is standing vertically. That is my reason of choosing VLOOKUP. Okay, we have cases where you can choose HLOOKUP. Okay, but for this case, because the data is standing vertically, so that is the reason why I'm using VLOOKUP. Okay, now if you look at the lookup function int again, the clue for the lookup formula, you see that it's asking for the lookup value. Okay, now the lookup value, like I said, is the brick code, which is the common data between this file and the bricks file. So the lookup value is this B7, because that is where I'm going to type in the brick code. All right, so B7. So anytime I type B7, it's going to look up. Anytime I type the brick code in B7, it's going to look up the brick name from the brick file and return it in B9. Okay, so now you can see after the lookup value, you have a comma. So you place your comma. Then the next thing is asking is the table array. All right, the table array. So this is when you will now click the file, click and select the table array. This is the table array. Okay, please do not select the label. Okay, do not select the label. You can see that I just selected the data under the labels. Under the labels, do not select the label. Brick code and brick name is the label. Okay, so I only selected just the data under the label. So after that, again, you can see comma. So I place my comma. Now it's asking me to, it's highlighting column index. The column index is the column I am going to be looking at to return the data. All right, the column where the data I'm returning is. Okay, if you look at this table array that I've selected, I selected table array A2 to B16. That's the table array that I selected, and I'm returning the brick name. I'm going to return the brick name, so I'm going to type in 2, because 2 is at column 2 of the table array. Okay, so comma, then comma again, 2 comma again, then you click on false for exact match. Okay, so I'll click false for exact match. I'm going to do another video again where I'm going to explain where you click on true for approximate match. So false for exact match, because there's no approximation here. It's C for Chilton, H for Honeybuff, L for Longville, like that. So it's exact. There's no approximation. So that's the reason why I'm choosing false for exact match. Okay, so now once I'm done, I close my bracket. You can see that the clue or the hint for the lookup function has disappeared. So once I finish that, I will just press enter. Okay, now you're going to see this hash not applicable message here. All right, now it's looking as if it's an error. It's not an error, because if I come here now and type, let me type C. C is Chilton, so let's see. So if I type C here now and press enter, you see it return Chilton, which is the correct brick name from the brick table. Okay, so that is how you can get that. That's how you can type in the formulas to return that. Okay, if I clear the C, you see it comes to this again. So that's done. So we have done the step number 19. We have typed in the formula, and this is 5 marks. You can see 5 marks. So they are going to be marking the lookup value, the correct function you use, the table array, at the time they add everything up together, you are going to be getting 5 marks for just typing that one formula using the lookup function. Okay, so I'm going to stop the video at this point and continue with this other part. So I'm continuing with this other part. So just look out for the other file and continue with step number 20. Okay, all right. Welcome to the finishing part of this video of the paper 3 data analytics of the 2018 mid-June examination series. Okay, so I'm going to finish this paper right away, straight away, starting from step number 20. All right, so we ended at step number 19 in the first part of this video, so I'm going to complete the remaining part and show you how you can print and finish up this part of this paper. Okay, so all right, okay, so step number 20 says enter a formula in cell B11, okay, to calculate the number of bricks required for a wall. You can only buy a whole brick. You know, like I said before, you need to pay attention to the instructions in the paper. You see, you can only buy a whole brick. This is an instruction. You can only buy a whole brick is an instruction. So everything that is being written must be read and understood. There's information for everything that is being written in your IGCSE ICT practical paper. So don't take them for granted. All right. So, so for this formula in B11, all right, before then we have the information that we need to be able to do that. All right. It said some walls are single skin walls. These are one brick thick. All right. So remember we did valediction for S and D. All right, so so single skin is for S, okay. Then it said stronger walls are double skin. Double skin is for D. If you remember, these are two brick thick, okay. These are two brick thick, bricks thick, okay. All right, now it said to calculate the number of bricks that will be required for a single skin wall. The following formula is used. Okay, the following formula is used. So, what's the formula now? The length and height of the wall are multiplied together. Then, the next bullet point saying, this is divided by the face area of each brick. All right. Okay, this is for single skin. So for single skin, we have length times height, then divide by the face area of the brick. Okay, then I said twice as many bricks are needed for a double skin wall. Okay, so that means we are going to multiply this by two if it's a double skin. All right, so we're going to multiply this by two. Okay, if it's a double skin. All right, then for both double skin and single skin walls, an extra 10% is always added as some bricks may be damaged. All right, an extra 50 bricks are added as some we need to be cut. Okay, so you can see now, let's try to analyze this formula. Let me go to my whiteboard. So let's try to see what's going on here. So in the formula, if it is if it is X, that's for Sigu skin, we're going to have the length multiplied by the height, okay, multiplied by the height, then we divide it by the face area, okay, divided by the face area if it's a single skin. Now double of this, twice as many are needed for double skin. So if it's now D, if it's not D, so we're just going to have, we're just going to multiply 2 into L by the height, okay, so by the height, and divide by we need to get this properly done. So we're going to multiply everything here by 2. So multiply by H A. So we're going to have, if it's double skin, if it's D for double skin, so it's going to calculate this. Alright, calculate this. So this, you know, remember what I told you about the if function. So if it is X, you must, this will be calculated. So if it's not X, that means it's D, this one will be calculated. Okay, if it is X, this will be calculated. That's for single skin X, this will be calculated and return. But if it's not X, that means it's going to be D. So that means this one will be calculated. Okay, this other part for D will be calculated. Okay, so so this first part of the formula is done. Now let's see. Now it said for both double skin and single skin walls, an extra 10% is added. Okay, an extra 10% is added. So if any of them is being calculated, an extra 10% is always added. All right, so we are going to multiply the if function by a factor of 10% and add it to, and add 50 to it, and add 50 to it. Now here they said for both double skin and single skin walls, an extra 10%. An extra 10% is an extra 10%. That means we're having extra. So the one there before is 100%. So you now have an extra 10%. Okay, so this will give you a total of 110%. Okay, this will give you a total of 100. If you convert this to a fraction, you're going to have a factor of that is 110/100. That will give you 1.1. okay, so we're going to have a multiplying factor of 1.1. okay, and also they said an extra 50 bricks is added as some will be cut, okay. So that means we're going to have 50 plus this multiplying factor 1.1, okay, then multiply by multiplying if, okay, so depending of if it is single, whatever that is being calculated will now be added to this, okay, and if it is double, whatever that is being calculated will also be added to this. So our formula is going to start with 50 plus 1.1 multiply by if, okay, multiply by if. So that's how we are going to get this formula done. So let's go back to our spreadsheet to to see how we're going to do that. Okay, so we're going to type this formula in cell B11, and this is 9 marks. We must not make any mistake here. We have to get the whole 9 marks from this formula. Okay, so let's go there. So B11, so this is row 11 and this is B11. This is B11. Okay, so so from our analysis, we're going to have 50 plus 1.1. Okay, let me start that. So equal to, so we have 50, right? Please, I want you to pay attention very well here. Let's see what I'm going to do. 50, so I'm going to have the plus, all right, 1.1. So how I got that multiplying factor of 1.1, an extra 10%. Yeah. So now asterisk. So I'm going to multiply this with if. Okay. So now I'm inside the if function right now, and it's asking me for the logical text. For the logical text again, the logical text is if it is single skin. Okay. So that is where x for single skin. So we say if before is giving us is equal to x, okay, if it equal to x, then if it's equal to okay, for single skin, that means if it's equal to x, all right, single skin is for x, so I think we're right. So if it's equal to x, then we are going to multiply the length by the height divided by the area. Okay, so if it's equal to x for single skin, then we're going to have, this is the length here, length of the wall would be, right, multiply as asterisk by the height of the wall. Okay, by the height of the wall, then divide this by the face area. If you check here, the face area is not in this calculator, it's not in the model. The face area is at the other file, so I'm going to VLOOKUP that file to get the face area. Okay, so I'm going to start another function. If you see now, we are inside the if function, so I'm going to start another function to get that. So just double click on VLOOKUP here. Okay, now you can see that I've entered another function, okay, inside the if function. All right, so now I'm inside the lookup function. Now it's asking me for the lookup value. Our lookup value is the brick code, because that's a common value between this file and the brick file. Okay, I've explained that before. So comma, now the table array. So the table array is in the brick file. All right, so you can see here we have brick code, brick name, brick impact, face area. Okay, so you have to select this data here contiguously, okay, like this. Okay, you see I started from the brick code because that is the common value between this file and the other file where I'm typing the formula. So I select from brick code down to the face area. Okay, you have to select it like that. Okay, now on the formula bar top here, click on it, then I click comma, then it's asking me the column index. If you check, the brick code is this, column 1, the brick name, column 2, the brick impact, column 3, that's not what I need. Then the face area of a brick is in column 4, so that's what I need. So I'm going to type 4. I'm going to type 4 in it, okay? So because I'm going to return I'm going to make use of the face area. I'm dividing the height, which is B5, multiplied by B6, which is the sorry, the length, which is B5, multiplied by B6, which is the height, and divided by the face area. Alright, so the face area is going to be returned at 4 in this table array. So then the next thing is comma. Alright, then I'm still going to use force for exact match, because this is an exact match case. I've explained that before. Then the next thing is asking me now is I'll close the lookup function. Okay, you see, once I close the lookup function, it's going to take me back to the if. Can you see? All right, so I've gone back to the if function. All right, so now we have calculated for the single skin. Alright, we have calculated for the single skin, but they said twice as many bricks are needed for a double skin. Okay, so that means if it's not single skin, it's going to be double skin. Alright, now remember, your if function return one value. Okay, so if the logical test is true, it's going to return the first value. If the logical test is false, it's going to return the other value. So the first statement here is for the double skin calculation. Okay, so I'm going to put a comma now and say twice. Okay, twice, that's two asterisk. Again, I will multiply the length. Okay, I'll multiply the length by the height again. Okay, don't be scared when you're typing the formula like this. I told you before, you just have to follow the int step by step, and you get it correctly. Okay, you get it correctly. Sometimes students get scared when they begin to see that the formula is very long. No, just the computer is going to do the calculation, so all you just need to do is to put in the right parameters or the right values or the right data that the computer is going to use to do the calculation. Before you finish pressing your enter, the computer has calculated it for you. Okay, so twice as many for the single skin. All right, so again, I will divide by the face area. The face area is at the other file. So I'm going to go inside the VLOOKUP again. Okay, going to go inside the VLOOKUP again. My lookup value is this. Okay, so comma. Okay, comma. The table array is at the other file. So the table array is this again, and we are going to return the fourth column, because that's where the face area is. Okay, then comma again, then force for exact match. So I can close the lookup. Okay, you see, I've returned back to the if function again. So I have calculated for both sides. All right, so and I have the value if fox. I've done it. Okay, so the next thing that you are going to do now is to close the if function. Okay, to close the if function. The if function is not closed. The parenthesis for the if function is not. Anytime you start a formula, a bracket is open. If a parenthesis is open, so you have to close it for this int to disappear. So I need to close it now. So once I close, you see that the if function has disappeared. If I remove it, you see that the clue returns back. So if I close it properly, you see that the int or the clue has disappeared. So this function is ready now. Once I press enter, you see it come back, take me to my model. All right, again, it's looking like it's not correct, but let's see what goes inside. Let's test the model. It's good that you test the model and see if everything is working. Okay, so it's a type of brick chosen. So let's, as you say, please type please enter brick code. So let me enter a brick code C, for instance. All right, and this is a double wall. This is for double wall as deal. So let me press enter. Oh, you can see that you will need to buy 50 bricks if it's a double wall and the brick code is C. Okay, and double skin, so you need to buy 50 brick. Let's see if it's a single skin. Let's see, single skin still C is still giving us the same value. Let me try H for single skin. So we have honey buff. The length of the wall will need to be entered here as well. The length of the wall will need to be entered, and the height of the wall will need to be entered. So, but you can see that the formulas are working properly. They're working properly. If I delete this and I clear this again, so the formula are working properly. Okay, all right. So now, like I said before, let's look at this formula again, please. You need to read and read and make sure you understand everything before you move on. Enter a formula in cell B11 to calculate the number of bricks required for a wall. You can only buy a whole brick. Okay, you can only buy a whole brick. That means this function needs to calculate the bricks in whole number. You need to calculate the bricks in whole number. Let's see. Let me put for a single skin, and let's say we have a face area of the length is 30 and the height is 40, for instance, and the brick code is C, for instance. Oh, you can see it's giving us 59.44. Alright, this shouldn't happen because they said you can only buy a whole brick. So we have to make sure that the calculated result is in whole number. Okay, so how do we do that? Pretty easy. So what I'm going to do now is that we just double click on where you type the formula again. I'm going to introduce a function, alright, that we convert all what is going to be calculated in this long formula to a whole number. Alright, to a whole number. So what I'm going to do here is that I will just introduce round. I'll just introduce round. Alright, the function, the if function, and is long content comma, zero. So that's what I'm going to add to that long formula now, to convert whatever that is being calculated by the if function to a whole number. All right, so that's easy. So this is what you do here. I'll just come here and say round. So this is round here. I'll just double click it from here. All right, round. You can see the int again. I told you before, the int is saying number comma number of digits. All right, so once I do that, I will come to the end here and say comma, right, zero, and close the round function. Okay, so this zero means that it's going to be whole number. It's going to round it to a whole number. Okay, no decimal place. So it's going to round it to a whole number. So again, I'll press enter. All right, you can see 59. All right, it was 59.44. All right, 59.44 from your elementary mathematics is not up to it's not up to 60. Okay, if it were to be 59.5 upward, then it will be rounded up to 60, because it was 59.44. That's why he left it at 59. Okay, so that is how I've introduced this round function to solve that problem. Okay, to solve that problem. You can watch this video over and over and again, and try to get the logic of what I'm understanding and practice it. Once you practice it once or twice, you see that you become a master of how this formula works. Okay, so that's done. All right, so it says save and print spreadsheet showing the formula. Okay, this once you are done with typing all the formulas, this printing part is pretty easy. So save and print the spreadsheet showing the formula. Make sure it is in landscape. Okay, row and column headings are displayed. The content of all cells are fully fully visible. Okay, so let's do that. So we're going to show formula, then change our orientation to landscape, then show this, and let me show you how you can do that quickly. All right, so this is a printing part. Okay, this is a printing part. Now to show the formulas in this model, all you just need to go, there's a menu called the formula group. All right, now on the ribbon of the formula group, you're going to see show formulas. Okay, show formulas. So I'll just click on show formulas. Okay, now you see that it's now showing the formulas, but this time please do not make mistake here. If you print this formula like this, you have put yourself into trouble, because the formula are not showing properly, they are cutting. All right, everything must show properly. Okay, so what I'm going to do here, like I said before, double click the boundaries between columns to expand. So I will just double click here. Okay, you can see that the formulas is now showing. Now you see the formula is showing, everything is showing. Okay, the formula for the lookup brick name is showing, everything is showing properly. So make sure you do that, make sure everything is showing. Then the next thing is said, the landscape should be the orientation should be landscape, and row and column heading are displayed. So I'll do that from the printing property. So when I go to file, I click on print, you can see my print preview right here. Now you check here, you see portrait orientation. No, they said we should make it landscape. So this is landscape. All right, so then another thing they say we should do before printing is to the row and the column headings are displayed. So if you check on the print preview, the row and the column heading are not displayed. So I'm going to make that to display then. Yeah, now by going to so print setup. Yes, so go to your page setup. Okay, so on the page setup, you're going to go to the sheet. Now when you go to sheet, on the sheet tab, you're going to see print. Under the print group, you see row and column heading. So you check that, okay, you check that. Then which other thing said you should display? The content are fully visible. We have ensured that. Please make sure the content are fully visible. So if I click OK here, you can see that the roll number and the column heading, they are showing. Let me go to the next page. So you can see that the formulas, they are showing properly. So even if you check this formula here, you can see that the round function is not showing properly. Please, this is not okay. I need to change it to make sure everything is showing. So one simple thing I can do here is to change the margin. Let me make it narrow. Okay, okay, you can see now that the cutout part is now showing. All right, it wasn't like this before. It wasn't like this when it was normal. When it was normal, you see it's not showing. This is cutting. All right, this is not okay. So make sure you ensure that everything is showing before you print. So if you click on this, is page 2 now, this is page 3, and everything is showing properly. this is page 2 and this is page 3. Everything is showing properly. So once all these criteria have been done according to what is said, all right, then you can now print. Okay, then you can now select your printer from here, then you can now print. Okay, you cannot print. So that is how to get that done. All right, from the page setup, you can, from the page setup in the printer's properties, you can get all these things done and set up before printing. Okay, so you say make sure that you have entered your name. This is I cannot explain this. You're supposed to know that your name, your center number must be there. It must be there. Very important. You can see our name here, okay, on top. Center number, the candidate number, and you can see the file part and the file name I was telling you about. Everything is showing properly. Okay, so that is what it's meant to be before you fire it to the printer. Okay, so step number 22, we are rounding up this part of this paper right straight away. Now you say enter data to build a single scheme wall. Okay, so the brick code is V, the length is 400 and the height is 60 centimeters. Then say print the spreadsheet showing the values. Make sure the printout fit on a single page. Okay, content of each cell are fully visible. Okay, and again your name. Once you have entered your name in the header or in the footer as they have mentioned before, then you won't have problem with this. Okay, you won't have problem because it's already there. But just to be sure, make sure that you check it that it is showing in the preview before you send it to the printer. Okay, all right, so let's do this. Step number 22, let's go and enter the brick code V. Length is 400 and height is 600. So let's go back to our model. So I'll go back, return to our model. Now you can see that my spreadsheet is still looking white. So let me try to adjust everything back so that I can have it the way it is. I will drop the show formula back and try to adjust. Just double click and okay, so now I'm back. So the brick code is V, so change it to V and the length is 400, so the length is 400, so I'll type 400 here, and the height is 60, so type 60 here. Okay, so you can see the model has calculated the number of bricks that I'll need to buy. 239. The model has calculated it for me without fraction. So it has calculated it in whole number value. So I should print this now. It's a print expression showing the value. Make sure the printout fit on a single page. Content are fully visible. So what I'm going to do here is that I will just I'm printing just this area. So I will just highlight this area like this. Okay, then go to file, print. Now on the print property, I will select print selection, and you can see this is just one page. Okay, and the value is showing 239. My name is showing properly, the file part is showing properly. So I will just select my printer and click on print to fire it to the printer. So that is done. So the next part here again is step number 24. This is the second print printout is the one we've done now. The first printout is the one that has to do with the formula. The second printout is the one that has to do with the text, okay, text data. So we're still going to print something else again. Let's see. It said change the model so that the wall is double skin and its height is 50 centimeter. Okay, its height is 50 centimeter. Print the screen showing the value. Make sure that the printout fits. So we're just going to change only the height and make it a double skin. Okay, so let's go and do that. So I'll return back to my normal view. So I'll change it to double skin for D, and the height is 50. So the height is 50, the length remains 400. You see it has calculated it in whole number again to be 365. Again, I'll just highlight like this and go to file. All right, print, go to file, print. The first one, did they say it should be portraits? Please, you have to check to make sure that this only says it should fit on a single page wide. It didn't specify if it should be portrait. Please check that. All right, check that. I think I meant to make it portrait. Let's see if we can change it to portrait and see if it fits properly. Okay, so this is fine because everything is showing. See the showing, but since we are coming from landscape, I will just still leave it like this. Okay, all right, they didn't specify if it should be portrait or landscape for the second printout and the third printout. Okay, they didn't specify. But they emphasize that all the content of the cell are fully visible. All the content are fully visible. Please check this correctly. You can see here the valley, what's here, it's not fully visible, so I need to expand that. Okay, so this valley stone, it was not showing, so I've come here to double click on the boundary between column B and column C to get it fully shown. So I can now go to print again. Okay, you can see it's showing properly now. All right, so please ensure that your printouts are not cutting. All right, everything is showing as they have specified. So make sure that you have entered your name, your spreadsheet showing formula, save and print the evidence document. Okay, make sure that you have entered that's on the evidence document. So, and this is 37 mark, and here comes the end of this paper. And actually we just treated the data analysis part on task 3, okay, using the spreadsheet program. So that is how you can walk through this paper. All right. So I'm going to do another video explaining some more content, so I would love you to look out for those video. All right, I'll share this video on you on the internet so that you'll be able to watch it very well and practice it. Practice is the key. Practice is the key. You can get 100% for this practical paper. You can get everything once you can practice. All right, practice is the key. So I'm going to stop this video now. And thank you for watching.